Sri Aurobindo is describing the nature of the essential consciousness of the divine Chit. His approach here is from within the human experience, looking upwards. And the strategy he follows, because he has to describe something which is not accessible to us as we are. So the strategy he follows is to describe things which are accessible to us, and then a little beyond, which are not perhaps directly accessible, but which are obvious when you look a little deeper. Having mapped those often lower layers, he then extends in continuity to the higher layers and then describes them in the same way and relationship as he has described the lower layers. So as a strategy, it allows us to have the evidence in the domain which we are conscious of, to be able to subjectively validate at least these domains, and then from there to project it to higher grades in our understanding. In the portion we read last time, he began first by pointing out that if we look deeply from the deeper soul consciousness, we realize that there is a consciousness also in plants, in metal, in the atom, in electricity, in everything which belongs to physical nature. The difference is only that the consciousness may be less outwardly expressed, but it can be equally or even greater in intensity, in rapidity, in poignancy within itself. So we tend to use this idea, this word lower consciousness, and look down upon it as something less conscious, especially when dealing with things of lower animal, insect, plant, or even stone. But the point he makes here is, in fact, within them it might even be more intense, though less expressed. And just because our mind is able to articulate itself and use fancy words to describe what it thinks and knows, does not make that power of expression somehow superior in quality of consciousness. The quality or intensity or other facets of consciousness may be even more in other layers which are unable to express in rational terms. Then he turns this external observation to an internal, first putting them all into one spectrum. All of these levels are part of one big spectrum of consciousness. Although they are lower to the chit, they are limited forms, modes and movements, and part of one indivisible existence. And then he turns inwards. In ourselves also, there is in our subconscious being an action which is precisely that of the inanimate physical nature, whence has been constituted the basis of our physical being. So if we are made of those grades of physical nature, then that action continues inside us. Here we have to be a little careful to notice he is not yet describing us as conscious beings. He is describing only the constituents which go to form us. So he speaks of these lower modes are the conscious stuff of inferior planes. They are not the beings, they are the stuff of. And again here he says, the basis of our physical being. It's not yet our physical being. Later, shortly, in the portion that we will begin to read today, he will describe our being, which is made of this stuff, which therefore carries the tendencies of this stuff. But the being itself is separate, it's an individuality. And that will be, we will come to later. If we don't recognize this distinction, it will seem as if he is repeating himself. And then he compares this lower with the band and range of awareness that we are conscious of as rational awareness. And between these two, there is a kind of a tension. First of all these lower levels are dominated and conditioned by our thinking and reasoning consciousness, that we have no real awareness of those things in themselves as they are. So we see our body. We think we are conscious of our body. The reality is that we don't really know our body as our body knows itself, as its instinct knows itself. I have a pain in my stomach. I don't really know what it is from, but the body knows precisely. The body builds the association. It has noticed that I ate this food provoked this disturbance, which led to this pain and whatever other intense reactions. The body remembers. And next time when I eat that food, unthinkingly, the body already prepares itself for that reaction. If it is able to strengthen itself and overcome, it digests it. If it is not, then it quickly throws it out and it builds a habit. Next time, I have to throw this out. All of this is taking place at a subconscious level in the body consciousness, of which I am totally unaware. And then over many years, I may notice, oh, I find every time I eat this food, I have a stomach upset. Now that I look back, I realize it. So my awareness is as if an external observer seeing only symptomatic, superficial behavior, not knowing the body in itself as it is within it. And this is true of all these lower levels, which he has described earlier, including the plant grade of consciousness, which is in us, the physical grade of the substance itself at a molecular level, at a cellular level, at the organic level, and still finer other higher gradations. None of those are conscious to us. But we are so overwhelmed with our mind awareness that our mind's thinking and impulses as if suppress and try to force them into its mold. So the natural rhythms of the body, the natural capacities innate and all these levels are all either thrown out of harmony or become less effective. You will recall Mother explaining this, that every time that nature takes one step in evolution, the strength, the greatest strength of the previous level is lost. And she compares the human mind entering with the earlier grade of the ape, which had excellent health, excellent strength, agility, suppleness, and it's as if we have lost all of that. It was as if inevitable, because in the mind's emergence, it is so close to the previous level, and yet it draws all the strength, all the energy out of that previous level, and imposes upon it a completely different value of its consciousness. And so all those things which would have happened instinctively in our ape layer of consciousness have been pushed, distorted out of harmony. And suddenly they don't work anymore. We mentioned last time how important the sleep becomes in such a situation where the mind for a while is pushed aside so that these other layers can regenerate and put themselves back in harmony. The wearing out, what we call stress, and the wearing out, which it is unable to regenerate, is all the result of the mind imposing its distortions and disharmonies on these lower levels. You notice all the stress comes because of you thinking about the past or about the future and not responding to the present in the most natural way necessary for the present. And since we are all the time either in the future or the past and agitated by expectations, fears, or things we can do nothing about, that layers, as pushes down as layers and piles up until it so distorts that we become a slave, warped in a way. And what's the correction? De-stressing? The two types. One is you make the mind still, quiet, or reorient itself to the present moment. Or you knock out the mind, give it some medication that relaxes. And at that point, you feel as if you're free of the stress, the tension fades away. In many cases of illnesses, including physical illnesses such as heart attacks, the first thing they do is they put you into a semi-conscious state so that you will not panic from the treatment being given or from the idea that you have a heart attack, which will worsen things. Your heart will race faster and try to get more agitated and lose balance even more. Knock out the mind, put the person to sleep, and allow the body to heal itself. Often they do this for 2 or 3 days. The net effect, of course, is that the family is scared. They see this person sleeping for 2 or 3 days and they say, oh, he has had a heart attack. What a serious thing it is. Well, it is serious inside, but it looks exaggerated because the person is unconscious, but he's unconscious only from medication, not from the heart attack itself. And so many of these illnesses which involve a buildup of stress are most easily corrected by removal of the mind. Now, what he's describing here is this suppression which distorts the lower layers and which makes the mind think, I know my body, but actually it doesn't. It's only imposing its own ideas and never really getting into those lower grades, cannot even. But we know this much, he says, and this is now shifting the idea to the nature of being rather than only levels of awareness. We know this much, he says, that there is an animal in us as well as that which is characteristically human, and the dynamic of the tension between these two we discussed last time is the whole essence of the distinction between the barbarian and the civilized person. But this animal in us is very powerful because in human evolution we have had much more time as animals than as humans. And the instincts nature formed at the animal levels are much more entrenched than the mind's instincts, which are more as if floating on top, superficially, not embedded in the body. So, he discusses these two and he describes them in psychological terms and terms which we can subjectively recognize. The animal nature is creature of conscious instinct and impulse, not reflective or rational. So we have an instinct, an impulse. What's the difference? Instinct is a kind of a knowledge turning to impulse. The impulse may not have a clear, obvious knowledge. I just feel like running away from what? I don't know. And it is not reflective or rational. So reflectivity is when the consciousness turns upon itself to observe itself. And irrationality is when it organizes and places in order its own experience or other experiences to make some sense out of it. So this lower layer is like that. And above that is a layer which turns back in thought and will on its experience, meets it from above with the light and force of a higher plane, and to some degree controls, uses and modifies it. So this higher level thinks, wills, but turning back upon all its experiences from some higher reference, light and force of a higher plane, meaning you are now able to push down on this lower impulse a different force, which is not impulsive, which is not instinctive, which is conscious, deliberate. I feel like running away and I restrain myself and stand firm. So there is a very deep insight regarding the nature of courage. People say so and so is courageous because he was not afraid. But sometimes foolhardiness also can appear like courage. I didn't even know that there was danger and I stood there. The real nature of courage we see is when you experience the fear and yet you are able to choose and override and stand firm. And then you know it is not foolhardy. You are aware. And where does that fear come from? In the lower parts, where precisely those situations where in our animal past causes where the instinct drove you away to protect yourself. Now with your rational mind, you're overriding that and asserting. Looking at a situation in battle where you choose to go and put yourself in danger. You have decided, let's say a group of people have decided that there's an attack happening. We have to block it here, otherwise we will lose everything of our civilization. So they go forward knowing full well they may not come back. They put themselves in the line of danger, consciously firmly establishing themselves against all their instinctive fears. And now look what happens. He says, from this higher plane, it can also exercise some degree of control and use and modifying the lower. Now this is the most important thing, because it is this possibility of the higher using the lower that will be later discussed in terms of a still higher consciousness using our mind. And this relationship is control, use and modify from the higher plane to the lower. So when a person has fear, there is of course a rush of adrenaline, as if a greater exaggerated energy, strength at that moment comes forward, and you're able to do things which you could not in a normal pacified state. So those who are part of the warrior clans or warrior traditions will train themselves to experience these exaggerated states of excitement. In their training of normal life, they will play sports where this kind of high adrenaline experience of danger is frequently had. They will do things which provoke that, and in that hold their calm and focus. So let's say in the earlier days you would go on a hunt, but a hunt where you did not have overwhelming superiority. You were yourself equally in danger along with the other animal. You had your own weapons, but you had to use all the possibilities of your reason and instincts to track the animal and protect yourself in the struggle which would take place. And facing the danger in a relatively controlled environment, you learned to, as if, control that state. You've not mastered it initially, but you're able to control it. I have fear, but I'm able to control. Second state is using it. Now I have fear, it gives me a certain intensity of energy, and now I use it by channeling it in a certain direction. In some of these Rajput families, even today, which were the families in the northwest border of India, the whole warrior tradition has taken very sophisticated forms, including social structures modified only for that purpose. And one of the things they have as a tradition is to drink a certain drink which has a mix of opium, mildly. And it is done as part of a festival on a certain day with a very clear objective. You do not drink it casually. You drink it almost like a sacred drink. It is offered to God and taken as a sanctified drink. And you are in an opiated state through most of the night. But what you do as a result is, having taken it with that intention, you are able to maintain a state of awareness and conscious intensity during the opiated state. And it was explained to us by one of them that it was the same drink that they would take when going to war. And the result of that was, first of all, it had the effect of numbing all your physical senses. So in case of injury, you would not hurt so much. By numbing your lower instincts, it gave you a greater sense of courage, which allowed you to do things which you would not be able to. And third, interestingly, It has the effect of making the blood coagulate faster. So if there is an injury, the blood flow stops quickly. Now these are things which were known to them. But if you had to take it just before going to war, then of course you are in a semi-inebriated state. You do not know how to manage it. But if you have done it before as part of a cultural practice, in a very controlled way, you have trained yourself to be able to operate in that condition, and then all the rest becomes easy. So you're using this lower nature, having first learned to control it, you then use it, modify it, and give it a certain direction. In some of the modern psychological advice, they tell you if you have anger, rather than blurting it out in abuse to somebody, you can channel the energy into work. So in a state of anger, you'll find you have more energy, you can do more things. Although there's a truth to it, from a spiritual perspective, it's not very helpful, because the work you do is from a much lower consciousness. And it's not helpful to imprint in our more active parts the higher grade or the deeper psychic vibration. But still, you can see how one could use the instinct of fear and channel it towards some meaningful outcome. The third degree of that control is when it goes into modifying. The higher consciousness turns to this. First, it has been able to control, direct, and then it says, but this fear is not acceptable. I can modify it and turn it into its very opposite, and turn it into courage by bringing in a higher value and a higher consciousness. Or I can bring it back and make it completely calm and free of any agitation, and so on. Jealousy comes up. Instead of feeling bad about somebody else having a special advantage, you can modify it and make it a source of inspiration and say, ah, if he can do it, I also should be able to learn, and I will follow his example and teach myself, and so on. So you can actually modify those states. In certain old yogic traditions, it was considered one of the aspects of the training of the emotions that you could consciously choose to enter any emotion and from there shift to any other emotion at will. And it was done as an exercise of training, as a way of gaining control and mastery over the whole emotional nature. In a way, this is what is done indirectly when we participate in theater. You have to play a certain role. While you play a role, you have to put forward different kinds of emotions, and then you have to switch them according to the narration of the story. And you find very quickly that you're able to consciously enter and modify any emotion by the conscious use of it. But this principle can now act all the way down in all these other layers. To the effect that, to the extent that the light and force of the higher mental reflective consciousness can penetrate into the lower levels of our consciousness, they can control, use, and modify each of those which belong still to our animal nature. Having described these two, which are part of our subjective experience, now again he extends the range. There is my human part, there is my animal part, but then he says, that's not all. Your actual animal part goes much more. He says, but the animal in man is only the head of our subhuman being. Now suddenly he's widening the picture. So we have this human layer. There is below it the animal layer, but the animal is the head of the subhuman being, which is much more. So below the human being is the subhuman being going many, 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 many levels, of which the animal is only the head. What is the rest of it? Below the head, below it, there is much that is also sub-animal and merely vital, much that acts by an instinct and impulse of which the constituting consciousness is withdrawn behind the surface. Below this sub-animal being, there is at a further depth the sub-vital. And then below that he discusses the body's consciousness. You will notice in all this description, he is using the word being, not level, not stuff of, not the basis of, but being itself. And so here we are describing something very different. It's not a repetition of the earlier thing. Although the content of that continues here, the being is the form of the individuality which has evolved from below upwards to the part where we say, I am conscious human, which is this very narrow layer below which all the subhuman exists. The animal part in us is only the head of the subhuman. Now what does that mean? The head, in this case, represents the conscious part, the equivalent of the thinking part in the animal. So if you look at animal life, you will see an intelligence. In the apes, much more obvious. In some of the more developed animals such as dogs, elephants, cats, dolphins, very obvious, but still missing the degree of rationality and self-reflectiveness which is natural for the human being. But there's an intelligence there, there's an awareness there. It is almost sub-rational awareness and sub-rational intelligence, but still it is intelligent. We have increasingly, in recent times, with sophisticated tools, we are able to map out the scope and complexity of intelligence in animals and in birds. And it is quite astounding, the recent discoveries indicate, that even small birds have intelligence of the equivalent of a human being who is 4 or 5 years old. Now that's a lot. And a small bird with a tiny, we say, bird brain, in a derogative way because it's small, even the bird brain intelligence is like a human who is 4 or 5 years old. The only thing missing is the self-aware, self-reflective, rational consciousness of that intelligence. Otherwise, the intelligence itself is equivalent. It can do things, it can solve problems, it can get around difficulties, even communicate in certain ways, which involve the same level of development as a 5-year-old human. So this is the animal below the human, the head of the subhuman. And the rest of it now becomes less and less aware. So immediately below the animal, below it, there is much that is also sub-animal and merely vital. So the distinction he is making is this. The sub-animal is merely vital. Meaning here, the aware intelligence of awareness or the awareness of the intelligence is not there. What is it? Much that acts by an instinct and impulse of which the constituting consciousness is withdrawn behind the surface. So the awareness of that grade is as if behind the surface. You cannot see or know the awareness, and yet it has the impulse, it has the instinct, and it acts by them. To the extent that the impulse and the instinct convey an intelligence of that hidden consciousness, it may even do very complex things. For example, a cockroach in flight. If you have ever observed, in the evening sometimes, they will fly around and navigate in the room, or you will find them scurrying around. If you chase them or if you try to strike them, they have evasive maneuvers of very high sophistication and rapidity. But if I recall right, I remember reading, the cockroach brain has barely 300 or 350 neurons, cells of the brain. And we cannot understand how just 300 neurons can have that level of complexity. If you try to replicate that with modern computer chips, with the same level of development, you cannot. So it's obvious that neurons are not the measure or the cause of intelligence. There is a consciousness behind which has the actual intelligence. It uses this machinery, which being less complex, is able to less express externally the intelligence which is hidden behind. And therefore we say lower grade of consciousness or less capable. But actually behind is still something which knows in a very sophisticated way. Now the proof that this is so is visible in some very strange experiments. I will give a few examples here. A cockroach is taught to navigate a maze. Now this is often done by scientists when they want to see how quickly animals can learn a complex series of instructions. To get to the food, it knows to navigate through a maze. And that involves already a very sophisticated intelligence. Then what they do is they cut off the head of the cockroach and join this cockroach to another one who has never been through the maze so that they share the blood. Strangely enough, the new cockroach, tied to the first cockroach only by blood, is now able to navigate the maze as if it has full memory and capacity of the first cockroach. Meaning, the brain is not needed. A creature that can survive without the head, that's first of all then the cockroach. The cockroach body can continue to live. Only without the head, it doesn't have eyes. But without the head, it doesn't have the controlling brain either, but it has instinct. And a very complex instinct. It doesn't know how to see where to go. You know, there's this phrase, headless chicken. I think a chicken also, I've not seen that, but it can survive even with its head removed for a while at least. But the idea being, we think of the brain as the center of intelligence and the one which holds all the intelligence. You remove that and you realize the intelligence is not in the brain, it's not in the neurons. As long as the body can survive, the intelligence from within can act and even guide to make complex behavior. In this case, the only link is the bloodstream, shared blood, which conveys the full knowledge of how to navigate a maze. Now, if you look at it purely from biological terms, you can't explain it. Where is the knowledge held? In the blood, but the blood is a fluid. It's changing all the time. So it's not obviously just the blood. There is in and infused in the blood subtler gradations of substance, equivalent from our description last time and discussion last time of the tree sap, the juice, the life force of the tree, of which the blood is only the most superficial layer. It's the carrier, so to say, of the sap of life force. That is what retains or dynamizes and expresses the intelligence, which is behind that. So there's as if a mental body, very crudely formed, which holds the real intelligence. There's the life force which translates the intelligence in terms of impulses, instincts, and that being seated in the blood is able to hold, retain the intelligence and the drive of the force and transfer it into another cockroach. Now, when you think of it in these terms, it makes a whole lot of sense. The same in principle would happen with human beings. One could, in principle, imprint intelligence and the impulse of life force directly into someone else. It's interesting that in certain old cultures, especially tribal cultures, one of the ways by which they seal a bond of friendship or a promise is by calling themselves blood brothers. So they make a slight cut on their hand and join where they have made a cut. So it's as if the blood is momentarily connected or exchanged. And after that, they call themselves blood brothers, meaning effectively we are one family, we will never betray each other, never deceive each other. What's the idea behind that? It's not just a ritual, there's a deep truth to it. You're creating on a subtle physical level a bond and a connection. I give another strange example. there's a particular creature, red colored, I do not know what name it is, what it is named. You see it often in the forest soil just after rains. The red colored things, you see them in Oroville also. And during the Second World War, in the Northeast region, we had some of the freedom fighters who were fighting, I don't know, the British or Japanese or whatever it was. And they had to find some ways to communicate. By then, the telegraph was quite common. But they couldn't afford the telegraph. And I was told this story by the son of one of those freedom fighters, that one of the methods they used for communication was that they would catch these red beetles, some kind of beetle. But they looked for two beetles which had just mated. And once they had mated and they were separated, one side took one beetle, the other side took the other beetle. And the strange thing was, if you flipped one of them, turned it upside down, it would struggle, the other one would flip over immediately. And that was the way that they communicated. It was their telegraph. So you'd flip one, the other one would flip. You flip it again, the other would flip. And they, in a kind of a Morse code, they would send messages in this way. Now you wonder, what is this? They have just mated. And during the mating process, again, there is exchange of physical energy. And in that, it's equivalent to the blood exchange, there is a very strong, subtle physical connection bond that is made. And to the degree that these creatures are not developed in a rationality and reflective awareness, they're still living on this instinctive layer where the drive is from a consciousness which is hidden. Once that bond is made at the level of that drive, flipping one would tend to flip the other. Interesting. So this is true when you go to that layer where the self-reflective awareness doesn't exist, or even the consciousness is not clear, obviously seen. It is hidden behind. The physical apparatus for organizing an expression of consciousness is very weak or undeveloped or even non-existent. This we see in plants. And in the plants, you do not have an obvious form of nervous system or neuronal cells. They have the sap, the juice going, which is equivalent to a bloodstream, and through that everything else takes place. And so there you do not see any kind of organized self-awareness possible, at least according to our understanding. But in fact there is, except it is behind. And what is expressed on the front is only the impulse and the instinct. Now what happens if you observe a plant growing? There are some plants which are climbing plants, creepers. They need something to hold and then they want to climb. Now you ask yourself, why? What in the plant makes it want to climb? Instinct, impulse. Who is holding that instinct? Obviously the consciousness behind, which you do not see. Not only that, it pushes forward this instinct to want to climb, it tries to curl around. And if you see, in nowadays we can do these films where you speed up the whole process. So you take over 1 month a series of photographs every 1 hour and then speed it up at a normal speed of the film, and you'll see the plant growing, struggling and going round and round as it climbs up. It looks so conscious, literally like some crawling creature, as if a snake trying to wind its way up, except it's growing at the same time. Now the interesting thing is, if you put the plant in a flat soil and you put a stick at a distance, the plant will quickly turn and grow in the direction of the stick, go and wrap around it and then start climbing. And the question we would ask is, how did it know there is a stick there? It has no eyes, it has no senses being able to reach out, but energetically it is able to sense. And the moment the energy senses, or the intelligence behind, knows, it pushes the impulse to grow this way, and then brings it up. Similarly, you take a seed which has sprouted and plant it upside down. The sprout will turn around and find its way to climb up until it breaks out of the soil. How does it know which is up and down? How does it know which way is the sun? Of course, one could still say there's a molecular process for weight and direction of up and down. But there's nothing there to show the direction where you go for the stick or for water. It knows to grow in a certain direction. The roots grow in the direction of where there is water and so on. So this is a layer which actually exists within us as a being. It's not just a grade of consciousness. It has an organized sense of, we'll use the word individuality, but not self-aware individuality. It has instincts and impulses intended to protect its form of individuality and to make it do things which it has over evolution developed as its way of being. So just as we have now this human eye, there is the animal eye, which is only the head of the subhuman, and below that, the purely, merely vital sub-animal layer. And there, we are touching things which are very close to the instincts of the body, but not yet the pure body instinct. So a lot of the survival instincts which do not involve awareness of the animal kind, let's say, when you are asked to stick, if you are asked to stick your finger in a flame, even before you do that, you know this is dangerous. If all our knowledge was built from experience, a newborn child would not know that touching a flame is dangerous. But he senses it. And a lot of that is, of course, transmitted also from the environment and the energy which he absorbs from his parents. But I will show you an example of how this works. As adults, we are self-aware, okay? We will do an experiment now which will tap into this layer of awareness. So become conscious of your finger, let's say index finger, and imagine your finger right now is stuck between the door and its hinge. Okay, your finger is stuck in there. So visualize it. And now in your mind, imagine, be conscious of your finger, imagine the door slowly closing and squeezing the finger. Just do it. And you'll notice very quickly your finger starts itching or wanting to pull back. Now slam the door quickly, ouch, your finger immediately moves back. In your mind, you have thought of a situation. But the response of the finger is not based on your mind's intelligence that this is dangerous. Your mind is saying it's only your imagination, there's nothing to it. But the moment you conceive of the sensation of the door squeezing in, your finger wants to bend and pull away. There's a kind of intelligence there. It is extremely sophisticated. It knows to pull in this direction and not just agitate back and forth. There's a complex intelligence involved. And that intelligence was triggered by your mind thinking of something. To it, the physical door squeezing and the thought of the door squeezing are equivalent. You see where I'm getting at? It is this layer of intelligence which, in the act of putting the finger close to the door, it starts shrinking already. It says, ah, this is dangerous area. And you don't put your finger in. It is on this level that our basic protective systems of the body have been developed. And that's why a child, even with no formal knowledge of what is dangerous and what is not, knows. In animals, it may take a more complex form. A baby deer meeting a tiger or smelling the tiger will know this is dangerous and want to run away. It has never met a tiger. It doesn't know that a tiger eats it. But the smell is known to that inner intelligence, which is not overt. It knows to avoid that. This intelligence actually operates all the way down, even in the purely physical instinct. It even goes down all the way to the atomic consciousness, which we may call dead. But internally it is aware. And so there's a huge intelligence operating on all levels of creation. even the so-called lower planes. But the intelligence is behind and concealed. So much that acts by an instinct and impulse of which the constituting consciousness is withdrawn behind the surface. What is surface? The things which we can see, touch, feel in form. Where is the intelligence? Behind that. We do not see it. It is operating behind, and to the extent that this object has the means of expressing that intelligence, it allows a little bit of it to leak through as instinct, as impulse. It is on this level that animals know when there is danger from an earthquake or a tsunami or a forest fire. They just know on waking up, today we have to run. And which direction? Not running helter-skelter. All of them turn exactly in the direction away from the danger zone. How do they know that? So on this level also, that you have the extraordinary intelligence in the bird to build its nest. The act of building the nest, remember, with a beak. You can only hold like a tweezer with two fingers. You can hold a beak twig. You break a twig, come and place it, and it falls. And yet within a few hours, you'll find several twigs interlocked in a way that they don't fall. And the further twigs built upon that, forming a circular form with a hole in the middle. Now consider what an extraordinary intelligence it is, what an extraordinary skill for a bird which has never seen it done, which has never been taught, which has never had an occasion to, for someone else to be doing it, from which it can watch and imitate. It just does it, and it doesn't know why it does it. It knows only that it has to keep doing. Interestingly, it doesn't even know that it will have to sit in the middle at some point, but it makes it of a size which is just enough for it to be able to sit inside. All of this is part of that extraordinary intelligence, nothing to do with the physiology and the brain. I had watched here once a bird which had made a nest, and unfortunately at some point a cat came and it ate what was in the nest, and the nest itself broke. I watched the bird for several days coming, looking for its nest. It couldn't find it. It was in great distress, very sad, upset at its loss. It went away. And we didn't see it for many days. And then interestingly, there were a few fibers left of where the nest had broken off, a few fibers left on the stem of the plant. Interestingly, after about 2 weeks, the bird came back, and now it was removing the fibers. Why? Because the instinct which built the nest, once the purpose of the nest is over and the baby fledgling has flown away, it has to dismantle the nest so that predators may not know that this is a favorite location for the nest. And it was coming back to complete the instinct. It didn't know why, it didn't know for what, but it was doing it with the same precision with which it built up the nest. Now, you cannot explain all this by a genetic transmission of intelligence. The genes are too few. In fact, one of the great shocks when they first completed the mapping of the human genome, one of the great shocks was this, that the human genome, they said, had about 40,000 genes. The rat had about 20,000 genes, and the worm had 10,000 genes. So we are only 4 times more complex than the worm, and that 4 times more is not enough to describe the complexity of our intelligence, behavior, consciousness, and so on. The difference between the ape and the human is 0.4% of the genes. All the rest are same. So that is not enough to describe the huge shift in consciousness, complexity, and so on. So it has been a big problem, in fact, after the genome mapping was done. Where is that knowledge, that intelligence, and all that complex behavior held in order that it may be transmitted? And of course, now they keep saying it is now in the RNA, not in the DNA, and all kinds of other things. But the reality is this, that there is a consciousness behind the form. It uses the form. The complexity of the gene is only a help for the complexity of expression of that innate intelligence. Now, once you recognize this, our understanding of evolution changes enormously. what is it that drives the step-by-step improvement in the form? The intelligence was already there behind. It is driving. It nudges. It pushes the instinct. It pushes the impulse to modify the behavior in small steps, and also to modify the genetic structure, which is nothing but condensation of the behavior patterns in the physical substance. And that carries over into the next of the species. But the intelligence is there all the way through, guiding the evolution. Therefore, Sri Aurobindo says, in the human mind, human intelligence, whatever the current development of our intelligence is only the little that comes out on the surface from the inner mind. And the real potential of our mind's development is held in the inner mind. If somehow you could bridge that and allow what is already there in the inner mind to come forward, that is what would be the development of the evolution of our intelligence. In other words, evolution is not something you are developing out of nowhere. It is the emergence of something which is already held behind as a capacity and a potential. And the gap in between is the screen which prevents us from seeing. So this is the larger discussion behind this. So when he describes this lower layer, sub-animal, merely vital, he describes it only as instinct and impulse of which the constituting consciousness is withdrawn behind the surface. So it may feel as if I don't see its consciousness. It is not conscious. It is subconscious. But actually it is only behind that the consciousness exists. And then, below this sub-animal being, there is at a further depth the sub-vital, below the vital now. And what is that like? And this he now describes as pure body consciousness. But he must give us a reference. What does that mean? When we advance in that ultra-normal self-knowledge and experience which yoga brings with it, we become aware that the body too has a consciousness of its own. It has habits, impulses, instincts, an inert yet effective will which differs from that of the rest of our being and can resist it and condition its effectiveness. And so first, before speaking of the body consciousness as a being in itself, separate from the sub-animal, animal, and then human, four layers, he describes the condition in which you can know this body consciousness as a separate being. So he says, first we have to advance in that ultra-normal self-knowledge and experience which yoga brings with it. As a result of our yoga, our self-knowledge, our experience of ourselves and things grows beyond the normal. Not only super normal, but ultra normal. It's a degree far greater. Super normal is only one step more than normal. Ultra normal is even more than that. It's at that point that you're able to really tap into the body consciousness. And then we become aware that the body too has a consciousness of its own, just like everything else. What does it have? He lists habits, impulses, instincts, an inert yet effective will which differs from that of the rest of our being, can resist it and condition its effectiveness. Now this is a very complex behavior. So first it has habits. The body has its own habits which are different from your sub-animal nature and animal nature and mind nature. Biology, purely body, has its separate habits. We'll touch a few examples of this. Then it has impulses, which are its drives, again different from those other drives. And then it has its instincts, meaning it wants to do things, it knows how to do things of its own. Now the bird's behavior to weave the tree is not part of this instinct. That is part of the life force. This instinct has much more to do with what happens in the body itself, in its processes. And then a will, which is very effective and yet inert, it seems to be passive. But in its passivity, what it chooses to do, it can resist what other layers want. Equally, it can push its need on those other layers. But passively, it is not seen to be active. So we'll look at all these with a few examples, and this will give us a clue as to the layers in which the spiritual consciousness has to penetrate, and when it awakens that layer, what that will mean. It will mean all these habits, impulses, instincts, and its will become conscious. Not only conscious, as our mind is aware of itself, they become aware of themselves, but they are not mentally conscious, a different grade of consciousness. But not only conscious, but then increasingly receptive to the action of the higher, including our mind. And so as the body consciousness becomes more conscious, our mind can will into it a certain behavior. Or a spiritual consciousness descending, an inspiration or an intuitive consciousness descending, can enter the body and make in it and through it what it wants to do spontaneously. So the making of the body's consciousness, the increase of the body's consciousness, is critical if the body is to become an instrument for anything higher, including for your intelligence. Look at what we need to do in order to do anything extraordinary with the body. A dancer, a musician, a gymnast, an athlete, even a bodybuilder. Anytime you want to make the body grow from one level of capacity to another, the process in between essentially is a process of making it conscious in that part, in that activity. When you play a new musical instrument, you have to move your fingers, make them conscious. I remember seeing in the old days, you used to have a typewriter course. It was considered a big thing because only those who knew how to type could become secretaries. Common man did not do that. Common man wrote by hand. Today you don't have courses for typewriters. Everybody sits at the keyboard as little children and they learn somehow, and it just happens. But during that time, I recall seeing all those sheets, because I learned it this way, straight at the computer when I was 12. But I would see other children going for the special course, and they were asked to place their hand like this, elbows like this, and then A, S, D, F, G, H, J, K, L. Forward, backward, and then alternate, and then every third, and all possible combinations. What are you doing through all this very laborious, slow process? Making the fingers plastic in activities which they are totally untrained for. The most difficult is the little finger, to push it hard so that the A will be a clear print. So in the days of the typewriter, the more sophisticated typewriters had a light touch. The more crude typewriters had heavy touch. You had to hit hard to get a clear print. And you had to print them all evenly. You couldn't have one letter dark, one letter faint. So you had to train your fingers to become equally strong for each movement. So the A with the little finger and the semicolon with the other little finger, these were always the lightest in the print. So you had a special exercise to keep punching until it becomes strong and conscious in an action which is very difficult to do, left to yourself. Now the people who don't go through that formal training, like the children who have learned just on the keyboard, or even as adults nowadays, people just look at the keyboard and just hit, you will find they don't use the full spread of the fingers. They tend to use the first two or three. They don't use the little finger. A lot of people start with two-finger typing. So you're watching and then going like that. And the little finger is still undeveloped. But if you take the trouble, initially you have a huge resistance in the little fingers, but if you take the trouble and build it, you can go very fast without moving your hands at all. Just the fingers move and your hands just go like that. And you can type extremely fast without error. Of course, you don't need to hit as hard with a computer keyboard. But what you have to do is go through that laborious process of making that finger and that movement conscious. The same applies if you're playing the piano, you're playing the guitar, you're playing the violin, you're playing any drums. At first, you are kludgy. By willing yourself and consciously infusing awareness into those parts where it's least developed, in that activity you develop a conscious awareness. And after a while your hands can do it on their own. Your mind can disengage, think of other things, intend something, and the fingers just follow. Mother observes how she saw, when she saw Sri Aurobindo typing in the Arya, she was typing for the Arya. She said the inspiration came from high above and went straight down through a silent mind, went straight down to the fingers into the typewriter. What does that mean? The fingers playing as they moved were directed from the intuition directly. And the mind completely silent was just like a transparent passage. Where was he? Obviously not in the conscious band of intelligent self-awareness. Above that, in the intuitive consciousness and above, seeing what he sees. And then there's this clear passage all the way down to the fingers, and the fingers moving to express in form of word precisely what is necessary. Now, we can have glimpses of this when we write poetry. Sometimes you're writing a poem, your mind is active, and occasionally when the mind is not active, suddenly a word pops up or even a line pops up and you just write it. It can also happen, a line pops up as you write it, your finger continues to move and writes a word which you are not even aware of until it's written, and you say, ah, that's a beautiful word, so perfectly cast. It's not automatic writing. You are aware of the inspiration and what it wants to say. But the form of the word is completed by the hand as if directly. And it is fully aware. And the hand is participating, sharing in it. Kapali Shastriyar had this intuition in the body consciousness. And he noted how he was working in the paints section of the ashram building construction. And he had to mix, in those days, to get specific colors, you had to mix precise proportions of paints. And the hand itself being intuitive, he would simply dip into the paint and take out the exact amount necessary and pour it in. If you needed 10 grams, you got 10 grams. You wanted 110 grams, it came 110 exactly. Because the hand would feel, would know. And all of this gives you a hint of what is possible directly in the body consciousness. But what is it now? It's not aware like this. But it is driven by habits, impulses, instincts, and an inert and yet effective will. So the habits of the body, you notice the habit of sleep, habit of hunger, they are tied to rhythms of nature. They can be modified, but modified partially. So you change a time zone, let's say you go from here to Europe. In large part of Europe, you would be now 3.5 hours away in time zone. At first, your body is still in the Indian time zone. And after a few days, it senses the sun's position and the variation of sunlight. And suddenly on the 4th or 5th day, it slips into the local time zone rhythm. Just like that. How? How does it know? Well, that's still explainable because, well, light is obvious. Let me give you another example, which is not explainable so easily. There are shells which open when the moon rises. Shells which open with the tide. So when there is high tide and the water comes, they open. And they expect whatever to happen, the food to come in to eat. And as the tide goes down, they close again and wait for the next tide. Now these shells are taken from the edge of the ocean, taken to the middle of the land on top of a mountain. kept in a room, in an aquarium. No sunlight, no moonlight, no tides. And they have a time zone problem. They're first for a few days, they're following the old time zone and the rhythm of opening in the old tide location. And then suddenly, third, fourth day, they switch. And now they start opening on the local time's tide if there was an ocean here. If we had an ocean on top of the mountain, when the tide would be high, that's when they open. How do they know? How do they know where they are on the earth and how they are aligned to energies? Actually, our body is deeply, intimately connected with these rhythms of the astral bodies. They're called astral in the occult science because precisely their effect on us is energetic, not physical. It's not the moon's location and its gravitational influence. It is the energetic astral influence of the moon and the sun which is acting on us at the level of our astral body. And it's called astral body precisely because it is influenced by those things which are astral. And so where the moon is now has nothing to do with gravitation and its influence. It has to do with the energetic alignment. And there are processes within the body tuned into that. And they kick in and synchronize and align with that. Where did the body learn this? Where did the shell learn to follow that rhythm? What is the intelligence which formed it? You can see that none of this can be explained by purely survival of the fittest type evolution. There has to be a sophisticated intelligence behind setting these rhythms early on, which would make possible the survival of the species. And the thing continues within us. You see, even in all animals, as far as I'm aware, it is the same cycle. The menstrual cycle is the lunar cycle, 28 days. Now, why does the body's blood flow and procreative process tie into the moon? Well, in astrology, you will say moon represents that or is a primary influence for that grade of energy. Why? You cannot say it logically, but if you stand behind the logic, our body is formed out of the universe, as if a condensation of the whole universe brought together in a small unit. And the things most powerful in their astral influence around us become then the synchronizers of rhythms for our energies. The moon in particular, if you see physically, it relates to the tides. The tides are tied to the position of the moon. In our body, therefore, the tides of life force are also therefore a representation of the cycle of the moon's influence on the earth and the tides. So the fertility cycle is related to the moon. Extend it a step further. When you plant seeds in the soil, the fertility of the soil and the seed also would be then influenced by that. And so a culture which is intuitive and senses this connection, feels it and knows it consciously, would synchronize themselves for this. And you'll see practically all the old cultures used to follow the lunar cycle during the harvest, both for planting and for the harvesting. Interestingly, not only for planting, and there are now studies which confirm this, when the moon is waxing, meaning the size of the light is growing, if you plant something, it grows, because at that point the lunar energies, fertility energies, are on the upswing. When it is waning and the light is reducing, at that point the fertility energies are subsiding. You plant at that time, the plant won't be as healthy or won't grow as fast. Transition points, full moon and new moon. Again, those are extremely important for this kind of work. But if you think of it logically with the physical appearance of the moon, the light reflected from the moon has nothing to do with the gravitational force. The size of the moon is exactly the same. It's only the visual experience which is the moon becoming small or big in its light of reflection. or its relationship with the sun. It has nothing to do with that. It has to do with the energy alignment with the sun, the moon, and the earth. And this is something one can sense and then articulate. When you articulate it, it becomes astrology. When you sense it intuitively, instinctively, you don't need astrology, you just know, this is the right time. The same thing, I'm extending this. At the time of harvesting, when do you want to cut the grains? You may say, the moment they are ripe, you cut them. No, that's not how you do it. Remember, in the sap of the plants, the sap is most intense, plentiful and nourishing as the moonlight is growing. And at the full moon, it becomes most intense and then again it diminishes. So if you want your body to receive maximum nourishment, you catch it when the sap and the life force is at the highest, just before or at full moon. That's when you will cut it, and all the grain you get will be the most potent, the most nourishing and healthy. So there are many such you will find in the Indian tradition. There are many rituals, festivals associated with the lunar cycles. The solar cycle is used for different things. The lunar cycle is used for things to do with life force, fertility, energy. The solar cycle has to do with mind, soul, and spiritual alignments. And the mix of these two, and both cycles are simultaneously followed, the mix of these two makes for some pretty complex festivals and rituals. But you see, when you get into a consciousness at this level with your intuition, all this knowledge becomes accessible and even obvious, spontaneous, without even having needing to go through any formal learning. So, the habits of the body, we digressed from there. One of the habits is the sleep cycle, eating cycle, and various other cycles of this kind, which are often tied to rhythms of the astral bodies around us. It has other habits also, which are more complex. The habit of growing. The habit of going through complex changes during the growth. Now, for example, in teenage, suddenly at a particular point, certain hormones kick in and your body becomes larger. It grows new parts, organs, activates some of these organs, and precisely timed, in precise proportions. The beard, for example, in men will grow. And having grown, it stops growing after a certain point. This is rapid growth and then it stops, slows down and stops. And there are many such transition points. What is it that kicks in? Where is the cycle, the clock, master clock, keeping track of when this starts happening? At the age of 42 to 43, suddenly there's a drop in the elasticity of the body tissue because of certain hormonal adjustments. And the first sign of that is that your eye's lens is not able to focus as easily. It becomes a little rigid. So you start taking your head back when you're reading. And very quickly people tend to start using specs. But it starts around that age. What is it that's maintaining the time? It's all embedded in the body consciousness. And the body consciousness has developed machinery of its own, which maintains those rhythms or watches those rhythms. You can interfere them with the machinery by mechanical means, such as genetic interventions, molecular interventions through food or other kinds of specialized molecules, which is the effort of modern medicine. Or you can intervene by putting your conscious intention in the body and from there shaping it. This would be the yogic way. If you did that, very quickly the physiological processes would adapt themselves to match the consciousness intention. Remember, in the evolution, the intelligence behind has been modifying the form. But the intelligence above, which is conscious, self-conscious, or even superconscious, can also do the same thing, isn't it? That would be the yogic way. And so, mother's insistence not to let ourselves become victims of the biological processes and instincts, but to always try to rise above, and infuse a higher standard in the body consciousness itself. And for that purpose, she instituted what once Dr. Kirit Joshi described to me as the most comprehensive physical education program in the world, which we have in the ashram school. Literally every part of the body in every kind of activity is being tapped, developed and made conscious. And there are a few quotations placed there in the gym where this intention is described. The mother says that the body must be made conscious and a receptive instrument so that when the time comes, the divine consciousness can use it for its purpose. Whatever the words, I don't remember exactly. But this is the intention which she wanted. Now it's a different matter that so many of the children pass through with no interest for this higher development, but they do have conscious bodies which have been prepared to whatever extent they have participated in it. But if one could treat this as part of the sadhana, you can see what could be possible, and that was Mother's intention. So these habits, being only built up from past repetition and the secret intelligence forming them, can now be reprogrammed by a higher intelligence. But there are habits. One of those habits which Mother fought against is the habit of aging and dying. And she said, aging and dying, death, death, die, die. And this, when Mother went into the body consciousness and then into the cellular consciousness, she said, she found there is no reason for them to age. There is no reason for them to die except habit. And the habit at that level goes back not just to our ape past, not just to our animal past, not just to the plant level of consciousness, but she said to the earliest levels when life first emerged out of matter, and it struggled to emerge and was beaten back, and struggled and was beaten back again and again and again for a very long time. And the memory of being helpless and being exhausted and having to fall back into death, that memory remained in the cellular consciousness and continues even now. Now, the truth of this, we can actually verify up to a point when we notice that our interest in the body and the drive that we put in the engagement with life immediately has the effect of revivifying our sense of youth. When we lose interest and we withdraw enthusiasm from life, very quickly you see the diminishing and the aging increasing. Again, you bring back interest and enthusiasm, immediately the signs of youth tend to come up, aging slows down. And this is a struggle between the higher layers and these lower layers. They are interconnected, each is influencing the other. But if we can have this consciously, and then you can bring in an intervention of a still higher consciousness, so much can be changed. The mother's own body is a standing example, and we have seen at the age of 80 she was playing tennis, defeating those who were half her age or younger. But the plasticity and the extraordinary beauty that she could express in the form of her body is one example. It's only when she decided to withdraw that the body began very quickly to shrink and fall into the conventional signs of aging. But otherwise, she was able to push it to an extraordinary extent. Having done that in herself with her consciousness at the physical level connected to humanity, suddenly now all over the world in humanity, this passage is becoming easier. So you'll see increasingly people being able to stay longer with good physical health into their 90s, and now more and more people even crossing into their 100s. But the difference is this: the part of humanity which is consciously trying to develop the body awareness and overcome its limitation is the one who is spearheading this part of the evolution. And they may or may not be obviously spiritual in their interest or orientation. If there is upon that a spiritual access to a higher consciousness, this can be done much more and far greater. If within that there is a biological proclivity for good health with good genes, meaning good habit of the ancestry, then again that process becomes very helpful, very easy. So there are many factors involved, but they all have to do with this habit of the body consciousness. Next, he speaks of impulses in the body. And the way these impulses come, they can be overwhelming, because the mind can try to override them up to a point, but to the extent that our mind is dependent on the body can knock out the mind if it interferes too much. And that's what he is referring to when he says that the will in the body can resist and condition the effectiveness of the higher layers. So again, the obvious impulse is hunger and craving for food, which is there right at the beginning in the child. In an adult body, you are to some degree able to restrain your hunger. But you'll notice as you hold back, after a point, the body starts pushing. You suddenly become weak when the body withdraws the energy being given to you. And if you do not do what is necessary with hunger or thirst or sleep, it just knocks you out, you fall unconscious, and then the body does what it needs to do for its survival. But the body chooses when you will get knocked out. Now here's the interesting experience. When you try to struggle against some such body effort to knock you out, you'll find your mind can will yourself to stay awake while your body is pulling you into sleepiness or unconsciousness, and there's a battle of wills. Your mental conscious will is fighting the body's instinctive subconscious will, and they're in a tension. And which one will win? Rather than fighting, you could of course align and work with it. But since we are not conscious of it and its need, we end up most of the time in conflict. So a lot of our problems with the body's health are only because the mental will has moved in a direction which is contrary to the body's need and its will. I'm of course going more into the will aspect, but I'm speaking first primarily of the impulse in the body. So the impulse to want to reach out for hunger. Another great impulse which hits in teenage is the procreative impulse. And it doesn't take that form initially. It is first a drive for sexual attraction or a need for sexual expression. In some, it takes a form of a need for procreation, which is to have a child. The sex is incidental. But these two are extremely powerful as impulses, and if not rightly guided, can even make people behave in complete form aberration, even madness. We see this in animals during the mating season. They will battle each other to the point where they fall down bleeding. Elephants will clash until their tusks break and they fall bleeding. Or goats will bang their heads until their horns break, and so on. And once the instinct passes, suddenly they are behaving completely normally. And where does this instinct come from? It is the life energy and biology mix on those levels. But the instinct to want to give birth to a child is felt much more in the body than in the life force. And there's no logic to it. When it comes, it hits. There are other such instincts which involve various tendencies for, which involve survival. But most of these have to do with the body's comfort and the body's survival. And there is not too much beyond that. And Sri Aurobindo describes the body consciousness in these terms. He says, an inert yet effective will. The will is not always obvious. It is often passive. When it doesn't want, it'll just not participate. It'll not accept. It'll just become dull. And so when the body instinct has been beaten back, very quickly you will find the body becomes more and more inert. The personality becomes less proactive, more passive. And it starts from the body consciousness, extending its inertness into the mind. You will see this in many monastics. They become passive followers. They stop being proactive in their thought or in their behavior. They fall very quickly in a very mechanical, narrow routine, repeating the routine for 20, 30, 40, 50 years, and they're comfortable. You push them a little bit out, and then they get disoriented. But that's really the body's inertness now pulling down everything else by a passive resistance. And the instincts of the body then are to do with the survival. We've briefly touched upon those. But this will is extremely effective, because at the end of the day, our mind, our life force are totally dependent on the body. As long as we are embodied human beings, the body can override everything else. I have not touched upon one of the instincts which is more complex and very specific to the body, and that is the instinct of healing and regeneration. You have a cut. At a cellular level, the body starts the rejoining, involving very complex intelligence. You have a stomach upset, the body craves a particular kind of food which will set right the stomach upset. You have some damage to some part, the body will go into sleep and stay asleep for long hours when you are in high fever or various other things, because that's the way it knows to heal itself. Now these instincts can be tapped, they can be modified, they can be taught to work in different ways. So when, for example, you're tired, you're exhausted from too much work, one of the instincts for the body is to lie down and go to sleep in order to regenerate. But the nature of that sleep is often unconscious. You slide into sleep totally unconscious. And Mother says you can teach yourself not to slip into that unconscious sleep. When you're tired, you deliberately don't sleep, but lie down and relax and open to a higher nourishing force that fills you, regenerates, brings back the freshness and lightness, and then you can continue your day. So I recall an interview we had with Yuman Bhai. He was one of those who had a titanic energy, literally titanic energy, and it had to do with the kind of being that he was. He writes in some of his diary notes how he could eat humongous amount of food, what a normal person would eat 3 to 4 times and still have a slim body and work all day long. And of course he would be driven to extreme exhaustion, and he would tend to want to collapse in exhaustion. And Mother taught him this. She said, don't do that. You lie down on the body. And this is what he narrated as I remember it. He said, you lie down, and then in your body you open, and in your cells you open up to the light and force from above and invoke that light and force into your cells. And Mother used the word into the cells. And then you will find very quickly your body regenerates and you can continue. And so he would do that. And till a very late age, you saw him doing these things. And in the extreme, during the darshan time, when he would be giving darshan messages, he would be standing there from morning when they start at 4 o'clock or something, all the way through till evening, as long as it went on till 7 o'clock. But that's how he died also. There was a point where the body reached its limit and it was too much. It was also a time when there was a decision to withdraw, so it just used that occasion. He stayed active till the last. But I give this as an example because all of these habits, impulses, instincts, and the inert effective will can be taught to act from a higher consciousness, or if awakened in a part or in an activity in a part, can be remolded, and that stays in the species consciousness and in the genetic transmission also, in the heredity. It is possible to tap into this body consciousness as we are today. It requires a kind of a skill. If you read this description carefully, then you can get a sense of it. You make your mind very quiet. You remove all personal preferences and preconceived notions. including everything you've been taught that is good or bad. Then you make your emotions very quiet and remove all your desires and impulses, which are specific to your individuality. And then you go very quiet below that to the life impulses and instincts. And at that point, you'll feel the body consciousness. It is almost like a dumb, childlike feeling. It's like a child who can't speak. It just looks, it wants, it yearns, but there's no movement. It just turns, I wish, that kind of feeling, but there's no wishing. It's just needing. And when you're very quiet, you can feel that. And you can place there an intention or a question. The question will not be mental. It has to be in the state of the body consciousness. What if? And you as if turn the body consciousness in that direction. So if there's an illness, what if? You want to know how to heal it. And you turn in the direction of good health. And in that body awareness, as you turn it in its intention, you will feel what the body yearns for. It's not a craving like a life force, but just a gentle turning and yearning, which is felt in the body as an experience of the body itself. So, to give a specific example, let's say one is in fever, one feels the body and yearns or turns to getting well experience. And then in the body you feel as if on your tongue a taste of something or a need for a taste of something which is slightly salty, it has this sourish taste and it has this particular flavor of, and it feels like this in the body. Now, if you've ever eaten that kind of food, immediately that will evoke the memory of that. But the way the body puts it up is not with a specific image or a form. It's purely in terms of the consciousness as it senses it in the body experience. So if you don't have already the mental memory of what that food is like, then you know what it is you have to search, and then you start looking for the food. You go to the shop, but of course it's not prepared there. But if it was prepared, you would see, and your body would as if a part of the body reaches out, this. Or this smell reminds you or draws you to that. Very specifically, in steps of experience, your body shows you and reveals to you what is needed. I'll share again a personal experience here. I've perhaps mentioned it a couple of times before, but long ago. At a time when I was trying to gain weight, I had been eating raw food for about 10 years or 12 years, and so the body had become very thin. For the height I had, it was too thin. And I couldn't gain weight. I could eat all the food I want. I could try different kinds of food. Somehow it never gained weight. And so then I said, okay, that's not the way it works. I have to see what the body wants. So following a similar process, I tried to feel in the body, what is its conviction? What does it know or feel will give it the weight increase? And the feel that came up, of course, in the mind it drew an image, but the feel was the rice, which is warm, and upon that a spoonful of ghee soaking and melting in while the rice is warm. It's very specific. Now remember, it is in experience that the body conveys. So you can't play with that. You can't apply your mind and say, all right, it wants ghee, it wants rice, I can take it cold. No, it's the experience that you have to connect into. Okay? So I had the warm rice, I put a spoon of ghee, and then with my mind I would remind myself, this is what the body believes. This is what the body needs to gain weight. That's it. Quantity did not change. Quality of food did not change. It was the same dining room food. In 6 months, I put on about 5 kilos. And I didn't lose it. It was steadily increasing. And then it so happened I had to travel. And I was in Europe. I didn't have access to rice. I didn't have access to ghee. And the food was completely different. Pasta and other things. And so I didn't know what to do. And then I said, well, at the end of the day, it's not the form of the food. It's the consciousness and the conviction in the body. So I kept that orientation and as if kept the push of the will with that intention while eating whatever food came my way. And then in that 1 month that I was out, I put on another 5 kilos. And I never lost any of it. This is the interesting part. Normally when you diet to reduce weight, you change your diet, it gains back. If you do something to increase weight, you lose it when the food changes. Nothing. It was just built up and it stayed steady. After that, it has been pretty much steady. I'm giving this example because it gives you a sense of how the body communicates and how you can communicate and infuse into it an intention. It does not work with your mind willing it as a drive imposing on the body. Grow, grow strong, grow healthy, be well. You can shout all you want. The flower will wither in the intensity and violence of the shouting. That's not how it works. You have to get into the body awareness and gently nudge it in the experience. That's the language of the body. Nudge it, this. And just turn its yearning as if in the direction that you want. Many people do this. They are literally driving the body by imposing a diet, by imposing a will, by forcing it to exercise. And then you're going headlong against the body's natural innate will or instinct. And so that creates a huge clash and a very unstable result. But this process is very smooth and direct. So I think this reasonably covers whatever one would want to. One more point I want to share. In the body's healing, in the repair of the body from an injury, at this level of the body consciousness, there is a memory of the incident of the injury and the nature of the injury. And the memory in the body is different from the memory in the mind. Okay? So I'll give an example of how that works. When I was in kindergarten, one day, my buckles on the side, we used to wear buckles to keep the shorts tight, and they were metal buckles with two sharp hooks. And they were not properly placed. One of the sharp hooks was sticking out, and as we were doing some basic marching, my left hand here joint scraped against the sharp buckle, and there was a cut. The hurt perhaps was nominal, the injury was nominal. But I noticed over the years, the scar of that cut continued. Now remember, I would have been at that point 4 or 5 years old. My body has grown afterwards. It has rebuilt itself many times over, and yet the scar remained. And I often wondered, how is that possible? Normally when you have scars in very young age, they should go away. But this did not go. In my late 30s, maybe early 40s, I went through a series of certain kinds of process which I kind of let go of the past, and it was like a rebirth in many ways. And then one day I remembered that, I said, where's that scar? And I noticed I couldn't remember which arm had the scar. I had to struggle to recall, and then after a mental memory I could dig up and say, it was left hand, the scar was gone. It was in the late 40s, early 40s maybe, late 30s. Not in the time when the body was most young and regenerative, but in the time when it was already beginning to get the first signs of rigidity. But it happened when the body lost memory of the scar, of the injury. And I couldn't feel in the body, where is that? This is the interesting thing. As long as in the body the memory remained, the scar was there. In other words, every time it was rebuilding the tissue, body's memory was the reference for rebuilding the scar, as it built the rest of the body. And only when body lost it, the memory, I couldn't feel which arm it was, then the scar went away. So when it comes to illnesses, and especially what people call allergies and other habits of the body, and they are only habits, it is on this level that one has to tap and modify the body memory, body association. And even in injuries, one can then cause it to regenerate and correct itself in incredible ways. It is the body consciousness, if correctly directed, can be led to do extraordinary things including, and this is going to eventually appear in our medical science, regenerating entire limbs. Because at the level of the pure body consciousness, that knowledge also exists. I may give another example here, which was once while traveling, I tried to pull the tag from the luggage. There was an elastic which snapped and struck. It cut through the finger quite deep, about half a centimeter on the fingertip. That's really bad. Any regeneration, any repair there would leave a scar for sure, because it's gone very deep. I held the whole thing together, the tissue, for the next 48 hours. I kept it under pressure. And with the mind imprinting on the body that it was well. No memory of scar, of cut or scar or pain to be retained. And I just held it. Even through sleep, I would slide into sleep with that intention. About 48 hours. And then after that, I put a bandage. Normally people put a bandage, wrap it, you have pain or not, but your tissue is very much conscious that it has been injured. And you are very much part of it. I did not do that. Only after I felt it was sufficiently fixed, that I put something to prevent water from coming in. But in a day, every now and then, in the middle of work, my finger would be like that. And occasionally my mind would turn to hold it. About 2 weeks later, there was only on the surface a little bit of the skin which peeled off, which had not fully healed. But afterwards, when that fell off, no sign at all, no scar, no cut anywhere. But it required a certain effort to imprint in the body that and dissolve the memory of the injury. And again, the same issue was afterwards when I tried to remember which finger was it, I had to struggle. Even now I cannot say what was the angle, though at that time it was so clear. There is no memory of that in the body consciousness, only the mind's memory. So I'm just pointing to these things because they represent an enormous potential that is accessible to us as we are today. It only means a little effort. And what Mother did was go well beyond this into the cellular consciousness. To be conscious of the body awareness is one thing. To get into the cell's consciousness requires something altogether different. It's of a completely different level, much below. But one day that also we have to work upon. But the principle here is, the higher the grade of consciousness you bring in, the more light, the more deeply it can penetrate and act to awaken and modify what is otherwise like a darkness. The subconscious is like a zone of darkness, not lit up, not aware. The intelligence and the awareness is behind and hidden. So something descending from above, awakening the light here, and the intelligence so far concealed now coming forward and filling and taking a direct participation. That's the double action by which the lower grades of consciousness and especially eventually the body will be awakened and transformed. This is what Sri Aurobindo says very simply, with a supramental consciousness working from above and awakening from below. That's the sense of this double action. So I think with this we can move on. Unless there are questions later, we can take on. And he concludes with this. Much of the struggle in our being, remember he's speaking of the being, because these are all, each of them like a separate individual being. Much of the struggle in our being is due to this composite existence and the interaction of these varied and heterogeneous planes on each other. So why are we the mess that we are as human beings? Because each of these four beings in us is pulling and pushing in different directions. It's a composite. We are made up of four pieces latched on to each other, one upon the other. And interaction of these varied and heterogeneous planes. Two words. They're different pieces. But they're also heterogeneous. In substance, they're of a different grade. In quality of consciousness and impulse, they are of a different grade. And all of these are acting on each other. Not one, you can say, is subjugated entirely to another. Each is influencing each of the others. That makes for a very complex relationship. For man here is the result of an evolution. Here meaning in earth physical consciousness, not in the subtle body. For man here is the result of an evolution and contains in himself the whole of that evolution, up from the merely physical and sub-vital conscious being to the mental creature which at the top he is. So all the steps of evolution from the merely physical, that means when we were stone, mineral, to the sub-vital, and then the vital, and then the sub-animal, and then the animal, and then the mental, inferior mental, higher mental, all of these things are simultaneously there. The top part is only the mental creature that he is. And that means when we live our life unconsciously, the part of us that is mental is only this little tip of the iceberg. All the rest is automatic, mechanical, instinctive, largely animal, sub-vital, etc. That's how humanity lives. And a few moments in the day that we are conscious and we make a conscious choice are the moments that we live actually our humanity. Try to do this as an exercise. Looking back at the day, at the end of the day, consider which are the moments that you were self-aware, that you are conscious, and you made a conscious choice which was not the impulse and desire or some will inside you. You stood back and deliberately chose freely. And you'll find they're literally moments, seconds, or if you're fortunate and more developed, a few minutes in the day. All the rest is mostly automatic, mechanical. When you're eating food, the whole exercise, where's your mind? Your mind is somewhere else while the spoon is eating and chewing. When you select the food, you pretty much pick by the instinct of your moment's desire. More of this, less of that, according to how your desire likes or does not like, isn't it? You never stop to think, what is healthy for me? Is this how much I want or less or more? That conscious engagement of your self-aware mind and reflective and rational part is rarely there. And so to make that conscious is the first step by which we can link to a higher consciousness. That's the part which can become conscious of the higher as well as the lower, and therefore it's the link point. So this being the description he gives, the next paragraph now says, just as there is a lower, there is a higher grade. And he uses the analogy of these lower ranges to show us the relationship of the higher ranges. And there we will understand the true nature of the pure divine consciousness, the chit of the Satchidananda. So that comes next paragraph. But right now we just pause with this idea that we are the result of the evolution, but we contain in ourselves the whole of the evolution all the way up. And you see this imaged in nature's process. When our body forms, from a single cell it begins. It grows to become more and more like a fish. From there like a tadpole, from there like a frog, then from there like a four-footed animal. Literally you look a bit like, almost like a dog. The face is different, but the body is shaped like a four-footed creature with a tail, incidentally, in the fetus level. And then it shapes out further until it looks, even the face looks a bit like an ape. And the last stage, the body form becomes almost completely human. The tail is as if withdrawn and it's no more seen. And then it is ready for the human birth. Literally the body is going through those gradations of consciousness of those animal stages of our evolution and imprinting upon one upon the other the levels, until this last part emerges. And after birth, that process continues, even in terms of consciousness, especially in the more emotional and mental layers, because that evolution is still incomplete. Not whatever has been achieved and permanently established is finished in the womb. But the rest, which is not yet fully stabilized, continues after the womb, until we come into our own as conscious, self-aware adult human beings. That's when our true journey as mental beings begins on earth. And as the evolution speeds up, more and more of what used to happen after birth is being pushed back into the process in the womb itself, including the stage where you are able to open your eyes. This is an interesting observation that 30 years, 40 years ago, when children were born, mostly they would be eyes closed, fists closed, head bald. Today, practically all children, when they are born, they have a little bit of hair, their fingers are moving, their eyes are open, and they can connect. It's as if a lot of the process of the awakening later is being pushed back as nature speeds up the evolution. And you get a hint of what's possible eventually. Increasingly, as the child born has a more developed brain, the consciousness of the child at the point of entry in earth life as a human body would be already more complete. And we would not need to go through that process of self-loss and the remembering again. And that's happening, that is speeding up already because of the push of nature and of course the pressure of the higher supramental consciousness working to accelerate evolution. So we are in a very interesting period, although in human lifespan still it's happening slowly. In evolutionary terms, it is enormously fast that this is happening. But within us is the, we contain all the steps and levels of the evolution. That's what is interesting. So any questions, any comments? Okay, yes, I will come to that. Yes.
This inner will, the will of the body.
Yes.
I try to understand because the will for me in my outer consciousness, the one in this consciousness, I have a will, it's I mean, not my mind, I.
Differently aware. Yes.
Okay.
Okay. So yes, this is regarding the body will. In what way it is aware? So I'll give another example, which you will be able to tap into easily. So let's look at the mental will. I want to do involves an idea of what I want to do, an idea which is not me. It involves a desire of my wanting to reach out, to grab, to own, to do, to execute outward. Okay? And so these are desire and mental will. The body will, you can feel, let's say you're lying down and you're half awake, just emerging from sleep. And at that point you're aware of your body, feeling a little cold. And in your body, you feel the need to pull the sheets to make yourself warm. That's the grade of the body will. Okay? So the body feels the cold, feels the need to become warm, but it is not as a mental idea, it is not as a desire impulse, it is just a need felt in the substance of the body. Okay? It's very quiet, very gentle, not assertive, not dominating. Not violent at all, but just a need felt, a yearning. And then there's an intelligence in the body which pulls the sheets. You're half asleep, you're half in dream still. You pull the sheets, tighten up. Oh, here a little cold, you tighten up. That's it.
What do you call intelligence?
So the intelligence here, we call it intelligence because it knows how to do it and what to do. Sometimes your sheets are a little twisted and your hand and legs somehow organize themselves and make them flat. Has it happened to you? No, the intelligence is in the way it is able to flatten the sheet which was otherwise twisted without your being aware of a picture of how the sheet is twisted, without your seeing, without your thinking. Just your hands and legs know how to pull and push the sheet to make it straight again. It's an instinctive. Yes, it is an instinctive intelligence. You could call it a mind in the body. And that's what we call the awareness of the body. But the body awareness, yes. So technical term would be mental physical, or even a part of the vital physical, which is much more on the sensation and comfort side. But the mental physical would be the part which knows how to stretch the hands and legs to make the sheet flat again. So on those levels in our body, at the point where you're half awakening and you're aware of your body and the body's need, all of the body habits, impulses, instincts and its inert will are accessible. If you catch that state and you can hold that state consciously, halfway up from waking up from sleep, your mind is not yet fully awake. Okay, but if you catch that, you can infuse into that body a different will, different habit, different rhythm. Or you could go the other way, you are in a conscious state now, you close your eyes and you kind of sink into that state of half sleep, body consciousness on the edge, and infuse into it. Either way, at the emergence point or at an entry point. Or the same thing done in a spiritual way would be when you receive a higher consciousness and then are able to shift your awareness down to the body, entering the body awareness state, and either infuse that higher consciousness or draw it or invoke it. So again, the basic practice would be to start at the time when you wake up from sleep, just remain relaxed and in the body hold the aspiration to receive the mother's light and force. Or at the time as you slide into sleep, you open your body, relax your body. Mother gives you this exercise of relaxing part by part until your body feels like a rag of cloth, limp. And then in that state, you feel the body and just open it in a quiet aspiration. So these are ways by which you will find very quickly you can increase this awareness and align it with your spiritual aspiration. Ah, lie detector. Yes. Yes.
And there is one process of mesmerization.
Yes.
So how that is possible?
Okay. Yes. We're short of time, but this opens the way to a very fascinating discussion. One is about lie detectors and the other is about hypnosis, mesmerism. What they are in this context, and this is important to understand. The lie detector basically is bypassing your mind and your emotions, because the lie is only in your mind. And if you convince yourself strongly enough with your desire, it includes some of your vital nature. These parts, which are not directly aligned to your mind and have their own separate consciousness, do not know how to lie, or at least they don't have it by design. And so all the lie detector machines basically tap into the body consciousness or the lower vital consciousness, which are disengaged from the mind's power of self-deception. When I say a lie, all of me is involved, all these levels, but these levels do not participate in the lie. They give a different signal. So in my lie, I say, I did not do this. But those parts which have the memory and know that I did it, they give a different signal. And so I'm able to distinguish. So practically all the lie detector devices, they tap into the body, skin surface, muscular tension, or some signals in the brain, perspiration on the skin, pupil dilation, etc. Now the interesting thing is this. The body reacts when you lie. It does not accept falsehood. Innately, the body does not like falsehood. It's not natural to it. For the mind, self-deception is natural. For the life force, desire as the drive for self-deception is acceptable. But the body is not driven by either of these. Its will is much more, as I said, like a child, dumbly looking, and sometimes even has a sense of wonder and surprise. And it does not have this distortion. And so it feels, what is this vibration? And something reacts, something revolts inside. There are people who are able to bypass the lie detector tests up to a point. And they are able to do this by consciously making the body so relaxed that its normal reactions drop below the threshold. But it's still there. And so depending on the sensitivity of the machine, you can catch. Or the falsehood of the mind, they bring so deep into the body consciousness that the body is taught to believe. And the method they use is, in the body, they try to bring the memory that this thing happened or did not happen. And then they are able to bypass the machine. So the lie detector is really detecting the layers of your consciousness which do not participate in the lie. What is interesting is, in children who are born with some damage in the brain, so they are, what do you call them, retarded. That is another word, autistic, dyslexic of an extreme type, but autistic generally. They don't know how to lie. It's very interesting. They will tell you the truth and plainly as if it's the most normal thing. And it's very interesting to work with these children because they're so frank, so direct, that you begin to realize you don't need to lie either. And there's no question of punishment. It's just a very open relationship. And so it is suggestive of something. In the new consciousness, Mother says, the power of the mind to deceive itself will be lost. And that's like we losing the skill of the ape. When we grow into the new higher consciousness, even in an intuitive consciousness, the power of the intellect to deceive itself tends to fade. And at that point, you don't need to lie. You can't lie even. It seems so abnormal, weird. It's like trying to twist your arm. Why would you do that? You just want to flow freely. So this is one side of the description. Only in between, in the intellect, which has the power of self-deception, is lying natural. The second question is about mesmerism, hypnotism. There again, similar process happens. The mind is quieted, made to fall asleep. And then these deeper inner layers are tapped. So it's not so much the lower layers, but the inner subliminal dimension which is tapped. Some of it at a lower layer. And at that point, one can directly put a suggestion in those layers where there is the illness or the imbalance, bypassing the surface intelligence. So let's say you have a fear. You do not know why. Let's say a fear of flying. And you do not know why. There's some association or some reaction on one of these lower layers. By making the mind quiet, by putting it to sleep under hypnosis, you tap into these parts and directly tell those parts you don't need to fear. Or lead it, if you're tapping the body, lead the body through the experience of the flying in a visualization under hypnosis. Now you're sitting on a plane and you're looking at this beautiful flight, you're looking outside and you feel good. You're imprinting the experience in the body consciousness to feel good without fear. And then you bring back the person, the mind pops back, and the problem is gone, the fear of flying is gone. So in this way, you are able to tap into those lower layers directly. That's the only thing which hypnosis does. From a yogic point of view, hypnosis is not encouraged because somebody else's will, with their energies, their preconceptions, and sometimes their warped consciousness also can get in and leave an imprint. So the best way is you do it yourself, not hypnosis, but you make your mind very quiet and directly become aware of those layers where you have the disturbance and consciously open or reshape, depending on what you're capable of at that point, open it to a higher light, invoking a higher light and asking it to set right the disturbance. To the extent that you're able to directly enter that layer, the result can be as direct as under hypnosis. Even under hypnosis, sometimes it needs 2 or 3 sessions if the entry is not directly to that layer. But the same principle would apply in the yogic consciousness and the direct method of the yoga. And in principle, in this way, you can reshape any habit from inside out and correct it very quickly. There is a lot of recent research showing how many of these inner layers of the body and lower layers respond to the mind suggestion in strange ways. When a person is under surgery with local anesthetic, with general anesthetic, similar situation happens as under hypnosis. And if the doctor makes some strong comments, oh, this person will not heal quickly, it has an effect in the behavior. If on the other hand, he makes a positive comment, even in a difficult situation, and says, oh, this will heal very quickly, it's fine, the body heals quickly. It's really the same idea when I described what I did with the finger. You kind of get into that and infuse this. This will heal without scar. There is no scar. There is no cut. It's one tissue. It's healed. That's the imprint you hold. And it happens. It shapes the body's behavior. The skilled yogi can actually put as if a bundle of energy with that suggestion inside another person. So it can take two forms. If you have a knot of distortion, you as if reach into that and erase the knot, wipe it out, or just tear it out and throw it away, and the person is free. Or if there is something which needs a correction like this, or a new capacity to emerge, you form as if out of your consciousness a bundle of that correction and infuse it into the person. And it enters, sinks in all the way, and there it takes on that pattern and that rhythm. And spontaneously from within you, that movement begins. It's a very powerful intervention, and it can be done with, if there is, depending on the nature and the kind of force infused, it can last for months, even years. And so a highly developed person in this capacity can intervene in many ways, and rapidly the disciples experience changes taking place in them, and they don't even realize how and when it happened. It was in this way that the mother was working on all the sadhaks in the ashram, when the numbers were still small. That was up to the early 40s, late 30s. And she said she was doing the sadhana in them. She was literally entering in their consciousness, shaping, awakening, infusing light and force. And the whole thing was being done by her. She was carrying people in them, literally. And then when the numbers increased too much, she said it was not practical anymore. And so that process she withdrew. But she put a general force. And she said, you have to make the effort to open yourself to it. But once you do that, then the same kind of effort and same kind of work can be done in you, even now. Yes. Mother gives this exercise to remove a sticky habit or a persistent obsessive tendency. You write it out on a paper and then you tear it or burn it as a way of breaking it. But if you notice what you're doing, you're becoming conscious of that. You're creating thread linking it to the surface when you write, and then you break this, which has a ripple effect of breaking that. So this we would call an occult process, meaning you have used a symbol and a representation to achieve what was inside you. The spiritual process or the yogic process would be the same thing. You turn your attention in, become conscious of that inside you, and release the knot, free it up. Or take out that lump or knot and throw it out. Equivalent to tearing, removing and throwing, you see. But since you're not using a symbolic representation, we will not call it a cult, but a direct and a spiritual or a yogic process. Yes. So in many occult systems, basically the same knowledge, the same foundational principle is used, but using symbols. So the patient now is represented by this doll or this picture. The medicine is represented by this device or whatever. You bring the two together. But it's an indirect way of doing the same thing in consciousness. So the occult requires symbols, rituals, processes, which are only as effective finally as you put intention in it. So for some people that may appear to be easier because you cannot access the consciousness directly. But as your capacity to become aware grows, it's much simpler and more complete to do it directly in consciousness within you. And has a lasting effect. That is an important point. When you use with symbol, if in the person there is not the urge to be free, they will tend to fall back into the old habit. If you intervene directly at the root, then it goes away once and for all. But what we understand is the principle is the same. You are using indirect methods or direct methods. That's all. So, fascinating discussion. And next time we move now to the whole region above. And the link from there to the mind and possibilities. And the nature of the pure chit, the divine consciousness, which is the source of all these layers. Which will be, by the way, the Friday after next. Next Friday I'll have to be out of station and we'll continue this after a week. Sundays will be there as usual. Oh.